Hello, welcome to Catholic Life, Ordinary People with Extraordinary Faith. I'm Deacon Jody Moscona. Thank you for joining us today. Today we're going to talk about Catholic schools and the impact of the virus and all that sort of stuff. And as you can imagine, to do that, we have Dr. Melanie Palmisano, the superintendent of schools for the Diocese of Baton Rouge. And she's got her crackerjack instruction specialist, Diane Talbert, with her. And so we're going to dive right into what happened, what was, what is, and maybe what will be.
Hopefully.
How's that?
Hopefully.
Dr. Mel, welcome.
Thank you for having us. We're really excited to be here. We have a wonderful story to tell.
I'm sure you do.
There's a lot of stories around the diocese about everything that schools went through, but they did a phenomenal job. On Friday, the 13th of March, we were notified at 3:15 in the afternoon by the state of Louisiana that schools were officially closed, with no warning, really, and no time to do anything about it. The good news is the principals were with me at the annual retreat, which was already pre-planned at St. Ben's on Thursday evening. And so when we heard that we might be having some school closures, and we thought it was the next week or 10 days, we had a little dinner meeting and we did some strategies and talked to principals about what that might mean and told them to go back to their schools on Monday and implement some good strategies. And well, that didn't work out because, you know, the plug was pulled. But they did a phenomenal job. They stepped up and really reinforced my faith in Catholic education. And the people that we have in our classrooms are truly ministers, because they were not going to let those children miss out on education this year. So they sprang into action, and it was good. The bad news is we had, you know, some gym clothes and some lockers that stayed there for a very long time. Yeah, I would not have wanted to be that parent getting those back to wash them a few months later. But everything went very well from the start. A lot of the reason that it went well, besides great leadership in Catholic schools throughout our diocese, is because we had some things in place as that were part of our educational program enhancement. Mm-hmm. And Diane has been very instrumental in getting those materials and equipment for our schools over the years. And maybe she could share with us some of what we had in place.
Sure, I'd be glad to.
You were preparing for something different.
Well, I mean, we were preparing just to give the schools and the teachers the things that they needed in general. As it turns out, we did two things that were very, very helpful during the COVID-19 outbreak. One was through the Title IV funding that we received from federal programs, we were able to secure several different student devices. Could have been Chromebooks, iPads, or what have you. And the schools had those on campus, so when students were told to go home to continue their learning, they were able to take those devices if needed. And now we know that one household needs several devices, but we were able to supply that. The second thing that we were able to do, and really we didn't know that this was going to happen, but we were able through a state grant to be able to provide IXL licenses for all of the schools, every student at every school. IXL is an online learning program that actually tracks student progress. And we had some professional development prior to the school closures for students, for teachers rather, to learn how to utilize or implement the program in their classroom. And so it was a bit of a leap for them to be able to organize their classroom from home and have the students use the program kind of independently, but it worked. It was an opportunity. Mm-hmm. Also, IXL, through their professional development team, was able to provide some professional development for our teachers in online teaching. So those two things, having the student devices and having the IXL licenses, helped tremendously. And then, you know, we've been able to continue that even after the COVID outbreak, making sure that teachers had what they needed to be able to continue the learning.
So let me make sure that for the folks that they get this, because I followed you and I think I did, but you were preparing before we ever knew about a virus, for the implementation of some special technologies for the future.
Correct.
And those technologies were going to be implemented in a way that was going to accelerate record keeping and educational opportunities and different things. And it was like part of Dr. Bell always talks about, we're on the cutting edge. Well, you were on the cutting edge.
We were.
And then all of a sudden, within a matter of minutes, you get word from the governor that we're not opening on Monday. And I'm guessing you had to get all your principals.
Hey.
Was it a Zoom meeting? We know what they are now.
Oh, we know what a Zoom meeting is, but we didn't do a Zoom meeting. We did one of those all-call emergency calls. Uh-huh. And we said, guess what? It was just announced and sent out a blast email and a blast message to our principals. But what is so incredible about Catholic education is that we're never satisfied, you know?
Isn't that the truth?
And we continue to work on behalf of our schools. Mm-hmm. Diane has spent a lot of time capturing the funding so that a lot of these products and these materials come at no direct expense to the school. I mean, all of our parents are taxpayers.
Right.
And it comes through taxes, but you have to claim those taxes on behalf of the parents. And that kind of advocacy is what Diane does on a daily basis to make sure that our schools are taken care of.
So, we have a situation here in the diocese where you have a centralized office for the schools, but every school has to function somewhat independently because they have their own set of problems. I mean, like you might be in Ascension or you might be in Livingston,
right,
or whatever, you know, across the river. So you had to coordinate all of that.
Well, Diane always coordinates all of that. I can't take any credit. Mm-hmm. Diane works with 9 local educational authorities. So that's like civil parishes.
Right.
But they're LEAs is what they're called in the education world. And so Diane has to coordinate that. But our schools for the past 11 years have pooled Title II professional development funds and various other things so that it benefits everybody across our diocese.
Mm-hmm.
So our schools are site-based managed. And so the schools have responsibility to manage their site, but of course it's always within guidelines and requirements of the state.
So, Diane, was it like you had momentum, you were working on something. Was it kind of like exciting to all of a sudden say, wow, I'm now the focus?
Well, it wasn't me. It was the teachers.
Right.
And their focus was the student.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they had to try to help families assume some kind of normalcy. And going to school, whether it was in the classroom or at home, was normal. And so each day they would open their devices and they would have school. And they did it through a number of different platforms, Google Classroom, whatever different platform the school decided to use, or the teacher, it could have been Facebook. Mm-hmm. They went into these areas and created classes for their students. So that was the focus. The focus is always the student.
Right.
That's
true.
Now, I have to tell some stories. One of our schools told the story of they had sent a message to the parents saying that you're now a co-worker. You're at home working and the child is at home working. And so the parents that night started on Facebook with, my co-worker is going to be reported to HR because they're not doing their job. They're running through the house and they're not, you know. So it was a lot of fun from that at the beginning. Mm-hmm. It was kind of fun. I'm sure it got old very quickly for parents who had to do, we really do feel for them, having to do their job and also have the students at home. But the teachers did a good job keeping normalcy and schedule.
Right. So this was the mechanism. You got to the point where the school year was going to end and you had to do end of year stuff to promote and graduate and do the things you did. That must have been pretty.
It was confusing sometimes. The state said that students didn't even have to do work to get credit, but that's kind of not how we roll. So we were very clear that students had to make an effort to learn, and teachers made themselves very available. Yeah. Over and over again, we got stories. And you can hear some of the great testimonies from our students and our parents If you go to our website, we have a video called Learning in All Ways. And that video is a testimony to the great work of our schools, because those parents said that those teachers went above and beyond to right. make sure that those students were learning. I really liked the teachers who had normal morning assembly each morning, and the student had to come and they had prayer and pledge, and they sang the ABC song and the 1-2-3 yeah. dance, and the parents got to participate. So it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I have to admit, I've watched several of those morning assemblies for obvious reasons Facebook.
It's a lot more fun to go to school now than it was when we were in school. but everything's learning,
yes.
you know, learning in all ways.
Well, that is awesome. So where we are now is we're on summer break.
Sort of.
But yeah. that summer break is actually preparing for the next step.
Most definitely.
So there's a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes. And I know we're going to take a break in about a minute or so, and then we're going to jump into what's mm-hmm. going on, what the preparation is for the future. Because not only do we have a past of the COVID and a present for the COVID, we have to have a future. For the COVID.
We do, and Diane's working on CARES Act funding right now, working with that to get everything in place so that mm-hmm. our schools can benefit from that funding to be ready for next year.
Well, that is awesome. So for those that are watching, know that the Catholic schools have continued to function par excellence through the hiccup. We'll just say it was a hiccup, and now. That we have a sense of what the reality is, we can kind of move forward a little bit and look forward, and we're going to do that after a short break, okay?
That's good. Thank you.
Thank you for staying with us. We're going to take a short break, and after the break, we're going to have a different guest, the assistant superintendent, and we're going to talk about what's going to happen in the future for Catholic schools, and I want everybody to know that we need to be behind the schools, especially during this time, because there's a lot of people saying, well, if I'm going to be teaching from home, why do I need? You need the school, I promise you. So we're going to take a short break. Stay with us, and after the break, we'll be right back and continue with Dr. Mel, and we're going to talk about Catholic schools through the COVID. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
I had to leave my parents. I had to move schools. I don't know anyone here. Everything keeps changing. Why is this happening to me? I'm sure glad you're here.
Change a child's story. There's a child in foster care waiting for a volunteer like you.
It's been a long time coming, seeming like we all been running, feeling like the Wild West, gunning. Listen to our elders shunning. All we see is faces, color. All the other races, other. Why can't you just be my brother? We don't have to kill one another all around the world. We are one.
Welcome back to Catholic Life, Ordinary People with Extraordinary Faith. We're talking Catholic schools today, and we're talking about what was with the COVID, what is with the COVID, and now we're going to talk about what is going to be, hopefully without the COVID, but we don't know. We're talking to Dr. Mel, and you have Mike with you. Mike Miller is the
Assistant Superintendent. Yes.
So we have the hierarchy of Catholic schools here for the diocese. So I know you got some information you want to get out there
right.
for the next semester. So
well, we've been, you know, we took care of what we had to take care of in March, April, and May. One thing that we do know about May that we're still sad about is the graduating seniors did not have that special day as they had always planned. But the schools did a great job. I mean, Michael and I checked with him, and he can share some of the details about what they did differently.
You know, it was amazing, you know, because that's a tough thing, you know, when you're looking at graduation and it's a celebration and a culmination of all of the things that you've done in terms of your high school career. And I'll say this, first of all, Dr. Mel met with all the principals on Zoom and talked to all the principals about what they were going to do or what they were thinking about doing and how to plan, but to also do it responsibly, especially with the governor's edict at that time, which was you really couldn't have any large mass gatherings. And the creativity of our principals was just amazing. You had the Ascension principal, Sandy Pizzolatto, literally went to every door and handed out a diploma and took a picture with the student.
They yard signs.
I see the yard signs everywhere.
They taped the valedictorians and the salutatorians. They wove those together into a video along with the address of their keynote speaker, and they added all of that into kind of a keepsake video for each student. And then each student's picture was shown, you know, with their diploma and graduation. And all of our schools did something unique like that.
Yeah.
You had, you know, I can say the same thing about like St. Thomas and St. Michael's and Catholic High and St. Joseph's Academy. They all had their own unique, but in a way that they could give kind of that special send off to the students. And even I had a son who's in eighth grade, you know, at Most Blessed Sacrament, and we went through the drive-through line for graduation, and I actually made the joke of in the car, and I said, are you okay with this? And he said, yeah, this is fine. He said, you know, there's father. The father was there, and his principal was there, and the teachers were all there. And when he got out of the car, they gave him a huge cheer. And he got his diploma, and he got a picture with Father Phil and the principal right there, and turned around, got back in the car. He was in his cap and gown. He said, you know, that's not too bad a graduation ceremony. I didn't have to sit so long.
and he wanted to drive himself, yes, yeah. But that was not allowed. Yeah. Yeah.
So the amazing thing is seeing all the pictures on the lawns of the graduates.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like, I hope that continues. That would
Isn't
be something
great
forever,
thing?
You know, mm-hmm. for when your son or daughter is graduating to put their congratulatory picture and congratulations 2020, 2021. That's awesome.
Right. Right. Some of them had the students submit the picture with the COVID mask and without it. So they would have that memory of, remember when I had to wear that mask. But it really was a time that people got creative and honored each other. And
right.
So that's the silver lining, because they had to go above and beyond what they usually did.
Right.
And Bishop Duca celebrated a baccalaureate mass here at the diocese. We had representatives from each of the schools. And
nice.
So we had a beautiful mass that he celebrated and with those students as symbols or representatives
right.
of all of the students who graduated this year.
That's cool, that's good. Yeah, it was a, my other son, you know, is in sports, and so the sports part of this is, we're not going to talk about today, but that's another whole sad part of this
right.
whole thing about
right.
how many of those kids lost
season. Lost this season.
But let's talk about the future. I know you guys have some planning in place.
We do.
We've
been working mm-hmm. with the guidelines or the guidebook from Loyola Chicago. They did an excellent job. It's very comprehensive. It has different domains, and it addresses three different aspects. So our principals are working individually, but then collaborating with each other to fit their school situation the best. The first is, suppose we go back in a traditional way. It's still going to look different because of the health issues with trying to make sure that no one gets infected. So, but a traditional on campus.
So taking everybody's temperature.
If
and,
that's what
you
it
know,
is
you know,
at
whole,
that time.
So
there
is the possibility of school with precautions.
Oh, absolutely.
Right.
In fact, we expect some of that.
Something like that.
The second is totally online. Suppose there's a spike and the governor shuts us down again for beginning of school. We have to be ready for that. And so we're doing some work this summer, and I'll share that in just a second. And the third is a hybrid model. So we're going to go back, but maybe not in the same classroom at the same time. So maybe we'll have to use other parts of the campus and just and do some online learning even at school. But mm-hmm. our goal is to get as many kids into school every day that we can. We know parents need to work, and we know that the students love, they now realize how much they miss their friends and they love being
right.
in school.
That's...
You know, part of learning is rigor, relevance, and relationship. And that relationship part is so much easier in person.
Mm-hmm.
So we're excited about that. Now, this summer, we set up some online, methods of online instruction, workshops. I think there are 56 workshops that our teachers can take
wow.
part in, just to go from good to great, because they already know basic things about how to do online instruction. But our diocese is the second diocese in the whole United States to graduate a cohort of ISTE certified teachers. And ISTE is the International Society for Technology and Education. They've been around for a very long time. And they partnered with NCEA, and so we had the opportunity to put some teachers through this certification, and we did that. We had about a dozen go through that. That group, that basis of what they did, became the basis of our summer learning.
Nice.
So we were ahead of the game because we were so forward thinking anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So it was really easy to do that. And then for our principals, we have the Summer Leadership Summit, and we have that for principals and assistant principals every year. That will be here in Baton Rouge. So we'll be socially distanced at a ballroom downtown in Baton Rouge, but we're going to have that. And we have Stan Phelps coming. He's the green goldfish, purple goldfish, gold goldfish.
Oh, yeah.
He's coming, and he's going to do some training to re-energize our administrators
Good.
And what they need to do. We also have done a partnership with our Lady of the Lake Regional Medical Center, and they're going to go using CARES Act funding, so no cost to the schools. They're going to go to each campus, and they're going to help the principal prescribe what needs to happen with sanitizing stations, hand washing, distancing, you know, where people have to wear masks and where they might not have to wear masks.
Right. Oh, that's good. Well, that's mm-hmm. good. It's good to know that there's so much resources.
Right, and planning. You know, there's a lot of planning that our principals,
Absolutely.
Because they're planning three different ways.
Yeah.
But we plan. If it's not illegal, we will be back in school in August.
Yeah, I was going to say, the one thing advantage we have in terms of structure and community, you know, is that's really a key part of Catholic education, is that communal
right.
experience. And we want that as much as possible for our students.
Right.
And Dr. Mel has really emphasized it a lot.
Right. Yeah.
Very important.
You know, the hybrid model you were talking about, it struck me, that's going on in a lot of university settings right now, because you can mm-hmm. Go to class, you know, once a week and take the other two classes online
right.
and different things. So
the difference is the nature of the learner and the age of the learner.
That's a big difference.
What we learned, one of the takeaways from COVID-19 is we thought, well, surely, you know, the K-2 students would have trouble. They almost were easier
because
yeah. you could say, do this ABC book. But the high school kids needed structure too.
Right.
So we learn that, and the teachers learn that. So, you know, we will keep structures in place,
right.
even if it is hybrid. But we
right.
expect to have some little bit changes in the time that we take in, because we're not expecting to have full bus service. We may have some bus service, but we don't know what that will look like, because there's a lot of rules about that. We also don't know if we're going back in phase two or phase three. You know?
Right, that's true.
So that's unknown. So our principals...
Hopefully we'll know in a week or two.
Hopefully we'll know. We'll know, and it won't change before August 5th.
It won't change.
Yeah, so... But that's... We're doing a lot of planning right now, and the principals are planning. Michael's doing a lot of operational support and looking at things and helping them with different guidelines and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's been a change, but hopefully this whole change sets you up technologically for even more... improvement in the future.
Right. Well, we had a lot of things in place, but now the teachers are realizing how valuable it is.
Right.
You know, the wonderful thing about our teachers and administrators is it's a ministry.
Right.
And so they'll do whatever it takes to evangelize hearts, educate minds, encourage
right.
talent, and embrace
Have
the future.
Have we heard that before?
they are all about
Words
it.
Live by.
They are all about it, and they live it. Yeah, so we're mm-hmm. so yeah. pleased and proud of them.
Yeah. I did want to touch on a couple of things before you leave. You know, normally this show would be all the new principals, And we're going to do that.
Good. We have some.
You know, we want to talk about them. What I'm really excited about is the president at St. Michael's.
Yes, we put in a president, principal. Well, St. Michael is now old enough.
Right.
You know, if, as a high school age, it's probably just middle school.
Right.
You
know? Yeah.
It's probably like an early teen. Yeah. But it, you know, it's now to the point where they're building buildings, they're developing, they're expanding, their enrollment is up. And so we felt like it was time.
It
took a year. The board worked with the, you know, because we wanted it to be a different sort of model. Mm-hmm. And they accomplished that. They did a good job description, and we found a great person. So we're very excited about it.
Yeah, the reason I brought that up is because so many people, you know, working at a parish and hearing a lot of parents and other people, you get a lot of people's opinions on what's going to happen with Catholic education. Are we going to have a decrease in enrollment, an increase? Father and I were talking today about it may be an increase because people want smaller classes than what the public schools can offer, you know? And so, you know, right now it's important for the people to know that the schools are vibrant, that they are as vibrant as ever, that you guys are on top of it, and that now is really a very special time to get your kids into a Catholic school if they weren't, because they're going to get even a little bit more TLC.
Absolutely.
You know, they always did, but now they're getting more.
Yeah, I think they realized it through this COVID thing.
I was going to say, I actually have fielded probably more phone calls from people who attend either public or other private schools about space availability in our schools because of our rapid response in terms of the turnover, you know, that Dr. Mel has talked about from that Friday to most of our schools functioning and sending homework home by Tuesday or Wednesday of that following week. And we were back up and running our schools. That's how responsive we were. And I probably fielded about six or seven phone calls from parents where they were either in private schools or in public schools where they said, you know, we didn't get homework for weeks or 2 weeks and didn't know what was going on, and there was a lack of communication. And I think that one of the things, again, that COVID probably really brought out for our, all of our schools is just that communal experience.
So we have to wrap it up here. Mm-hmm. What I'd like for everybody to realize is that Dr. Mel and Michael are right on top of this whole thing, that the Catholic schools are definitely an alternative. And if you have any kids or grandkids looking for a school, just give the school in your neighborhood a call, and we'll find a way to get them in, right?
And we have information on our website, csobr.org.
csobr.org. So just go to the website, call the office if you have to. And I want to thank everybody for watching today and sticking with us through the break. And thank both of you for coming, and Diane for having come for the first segment. And we're going to do the principles again, okay?
That sounds great. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us today. You've been watching Catholic Life, Ordinary People with Extraordinary Faith. Till next time, God bless.